take Polanyi into the time machine and to bring him to the present day. And my hypothesis, and I think it's not only a hypothesis, it's simply a fact, that in between the time he has written the book, and by the way, also when I read or when I discovered the book as a young student, you have seen my notes, I miss them now, but they were handwritten. And in the time between, a technological revolution has occurred, which targets the signs and the buzz. There is a new wave of a scientific and technological revolution, which not only targets, but also reaches the production of science and bodies in a very, in a new fashion. So I spoke of markets for bodies in the past, slavery and prostitution, which have never gone. But what we live today is that we have machines which produce images, words, and of course the bank system is dependent on the revolution on the information and communications technology. And I see that I have 5 minutes left, and so I put it bluntly. There is no way to recover the idea of protection against what is happening now, because what is happening now is, in a sense, invading the entire life of the individual and of society on a global scale. So there is no possibility of protection against these developments. I think we have to face them in a new fashion. We have to, we have a multiple crisis today. It is not only capitalism which is in crisis, but also the protective system of the state, which was in place in a sense to protect us against market fundamentalism. And I think we are in the situation that we have something like multiple system crises, and there is no swinging between enlargement and scientific and technological revolution on the one hand, and protection of society or state, because in the past it was more or less the liberal state which protected the family, the legal system, the production of knowledge, the production of art. It was under state protection, and this has been washed away by this new technological revolution, and it is not just an accident that neoliberalism and the new technological revolutions occurred at one moment. And let me conclude with one word that when I reread the book now, what I found important in Polanyi is that he was aware of the fact that it was the Industrial Revolution which turned money, labor, and land into commodities. And we are in the continuation of this revolution, which now covers the fields which were left out of the first or even second Industrial Revolutions. And I think we have to reconsider and rethink, and not only rethink and reconsider, but we have to think new. We have to think fresh and from the start by the help of our books. But they take us to some point, but we have to go beyond the point. Thank you very much.
Care may be possible a fictitious commodity, and I will introduce in some developments in this field of care. And we are not sure, but it's the question, is care a fictitious cosmology, and how we can try to argue this. And I try that in some steps, presenting you the details on the PowerPoint, but I don't want to read this PowerPoint. I want to enable you to go with me in these case studies too. First, let me talk about what is care, what are care regimes, and what is the new story of marketization. I think that not everybody in this room knows what we try to understand as care. Therefore, I would make some remarks. Care and self-care are everyday life conditions, and we take as care activities and relations, all activities and relations facing the contingency, the joyousness and vulnerability of life. So the purpose of care is safeguarding life and serving livelihood. And we all in this room know that capitalist societies are more careful or caring societies. They are careless societies, and therefore care is in contradiction with the capitalist principles of our society. So why is it possible to care for oneself, for others in these societies? And there I have to emphasize care regimes. Care regimes are the normative, institutional, discursive, practical organization of pet and unpet care and care work in our societies. In Austria, by example, we have a family-based care regime. Many care work will be done in the family, some care work in the welfare state, and so on. Care regimes are interrelated with employment regimes, welfare regimes, gender, migration regimes, and they differ between the countries. So, if we now have a look on the care regimes in different countries, we can see that care regimes are providing care and care work by the corporate, market or private sector, the state, third sector, private households, social networks. These different spheres of society are responsible for care work. Care is done as paid and unpaid work, as volunteer work in the private and the public sphere. It is basing on and building up divisions of labor. You know that the division of labor between the genders is unequal, and you know that we have a strong relation between care work and the migration regimes in our societies, and so on. So, and we have in care different so-called, we call it so, institutional logics. The logic of the market, the corporation, the profession, the state, the family. We are associating care with the values of the family or values of professionalization and something else. And care regimes are not only national regimes. They are embedded in super-inter trends in national policies and politics, and they are differing between the societies. The care regime in Austria is a very different one from the Scandinavian care regimes, from the Mediterranean care regimes, and so on. There are a lot of differentiations. Our main thesis is we are coming from critical theory. We will see that if we are taking the term Vergesellschaftung. Our main thesis is that we are now witnessing a new stage of capitalist socialization, Vergesellschaftung, of the social reproduction and of care in the frame of social reproduction. I only want to mention 4 points. There are some more, but these 4 may be important. The first is the industrialization and marketization of social reproduction and care. You may know some examples, surrogacy, social freezing, what Cornelia says, the digitalization and robotics, wellness in industries and some more. Then we have not only this development in the corporate market or the private sector, we have an economic shift, a form of quasi-marketization. These are not real markets, sometimes fictitious markets. We have a quasi-marketization and new forms of governance in the state and in the third sector. We know the term welfare and workfare state from social redistribution to social investment, new forms of of social policies orienting on human capital. And we have commodification and decommodification of care and care work by reconfiguration the paid and the unpaid and the volunteer work in the corporate market, private sector, state, third sector and private household and social networks. Some care is done professional in the state, some care is done professional in the private sector, others is done in the private household and so on. And all these developments are embedded in the transnationalization of labor, work and politics. These are not national regimes, not only national politics, we have transnational actors. For example, the World Bank is a very important actor in the care sector by enforcing social investment policies. If we have a look on that in the through the lenses of Polanyi, then we see that we have movement and counter-movement in it. We not only have these new tendencies of industrialization and marketization, we have social protest too, movement and counter-movement. We have care protests in the Global South for years, for decades, in the Global North after the 2008 crisis in the context of the austerity schemes. As a reaction on the crisis of reproduction, these are initiatives and and movements struggling for labor, social, human rights. They are local, national, trans and international, supranational. Then we have a fundamental criticism of capitalism in these movements. Parts of the Occupy movements have been care protest movements. And we have discussions about alternatives, modes of living. We have discussion, a new discussion on social justice. Social justice seems to be the question, one of the questions of the 21st century. We have a new discussion on solidarity. And we have new forms of civil society engagement, of volunteer work, of caring communities, of charity, and another movement to marketize charity. We have new forms of charity economy by marketizing such social protest movements in the results of this group protest. So that's the situation we think we have to face now. And therefore is our next question, is this a never-ending story of marketization? And we want to show you two cases. The one case is the 24-hour care and the care agencies, and the other case is the residential care communities. These are interesting cases because in the first case you have care as a business case. This is the transnational commodification of labor and new forms of marketization of care, and in the second case, the residential care community, you have one of these civil society movements for alternatives of caring, and these civil society movements are discussed to be new pathways in another welfare state. And we now have to ask in the terms of movement and counter-movement, what can we see in these two cases of commodification of care and care work, and how we can find their questions of justice, in the sense of thinking about a criticism of a careless capitalism and thinking about alternatives. And I only want to introduce you in these cases. 24-hour care is a very well-known arrangement. The commodification in form of a worldwide middle class migrant in a family care arrangement, how Bethier and other calls it. Usually migrant female care workers are living in the households of the employers, and care agencies are agencies who do the recruitment of these migrant carers. They are agencies in the private sector, in the third sector, for-profit, non-profit, and they are specialized on recruiting domestic carer and worker, usually migrant, female migrants. So we have this form of care provision in the global north and in the global south. And in the global north, and we have differing arrangements, and between global north and south, extremely different arrangements, because in the global south we have domestic violence as a form of organization of these arrangements. In our spheres we have forms of legalized care provision in this field. So in Austria we have a legalized form. In Austria, I don't want to read it all, 24-hour care is organized by care agencies, and they offer the female East European care worker recruitment. They offer legal employment conditions, controlled employment standards, professionality, competence, certified qualification, and so on. Availability, flexibility, financial flexibility, and that's the point, the substitution of family members and relatives, empathy, sensitiveness, emotion, tender and loving care. They provide care by they provide care in form of a commodified family substitute. That's one form, and the residential care communities in Germany I want to present are the civil societies projects. They are professional care arrangements organizing care in such communities, and they provide professional care support in new forms of participation of member of the family as well as professional carers. They are new forms of crossing private and public arrangement by creating new private and family atmosphere, and they try to respond to the needs of the care receivers as well as to the caregivers, but they are not financed in a sufficient way. They are working with precarious work, and they are working with standards which are undermining the employment standards too as well, but in other way as the 24-hour care. So our question is, if we have, are the last points I want to make, if we have to look at Polanyi and fictitious commodity, we have two points. A fictitious commodity is a factor of production and an element never intended to be marketized and sold. And now in this field of care work, we have to ask whether we have destruction by commodification of labor and care in the field of care work. On one side, we have a fundamental contradiction between the capitalist socialization and caring as a holistic concept, safeguarding life and serving livelihood. In this field, we have a very complex situation of informalization versus formalization, familiarization versus professionalization, new forms of the private and the public, and these new forms of the private and the public are combined by the following constellation. to provide decent care by precarious work. In the 24-hour care, we have precarious work undermining all employment standards of the society. We have the constellation of professional and or versus precarious work. We have a global pitting of precarities. The migrants from the Eastern European country are provide care for the Austrian and German society, and the receiver of this care are precarious because they have otherwise no feasible opportunities to care for themselves or for others in the welfare state in the frame of austerity schemes. So we have aspects of movement and counter-movement, criticism versus legitimation of this everyday practice. We have the criticism as this new form of slavery. We have the legitimation, these are win-win situations. The winner are the East and the West and the East European countries as well. And we have criticism in everyday life practice who are connected and related with criticism of the of capitalism, of society, of the lack of care and welfare state. And therefore for us the question is, not the idea, the question is care a form of fictitious commodity which now produces new forms of protest, new forms of protection, new forms of discussion on everyday life, on everyday life as well as on capitalism and on alternative visions of living. Thank you.
She's so thrilled to be here at this conference because it's so interesting and so important, and I share this, and I can assure you that also the preparation process was a very, very nice process. I would like to thank the co-organizers because it was cooperation at its best in with the clockwork Brigitte, but it was really a very fruitful and good preparation process. And the second remark, when Cornelia Klinger pointed at her handwritten notes. I also have still in my Polanyi edition from Zurkamp my handwritten notes. I took them in the end of the 1990s, because at the beginning of the globalization debate, when there was Elmar Altvater, Birgit Mahnkopf promoting this concept of disinvestment, Christoph Görg and I, we responded a bit using Polanyi, but also Marx, to understand better what is this globalization process about. This is not also, it was also a political process, a process full of violence. So I'm a bit nervous because I talk many times about the imperial mode of living, and I work on this concept as Marcus Wissen since some time, and also with other colleagues now, and I published articles. But within the last year, I was working with Marcus on a book which comes out in March in German, and then in the fall we'll have another version with Roman and Linfield in English. And you can talk many times and you sharpen your thoughts throughout the talks, but after having thought and discussed for a year the concept of the imperial mode of living, I will see how it works, and I hope that it's not now too complex, because we added many things, many dimensions, and we have also in our book very historical parts, the historical evolvement of the imperial mode of living, Butter for the Fish, I don't know if this exists in English, Butter by the Fisher, and we have a chapter on the imperial automobility, but I will present you mainly the concept without case studies as Brigitte just did. I have three steps. Brigitte mentioned yesterday, or she took four steps. The first is very short. Our points of departure, if you like, the opening problem, as Bob said in the morning. Then the largest step is the concept and different facets of the concept. I go through them during my talk. And The last is then to link the concept of the improvement of living with the work of Polanyi. And I went in the last days again through our manuscript, the book manuscript, and some articles, and I have to confess that we refer more to Marx, Gramsci, Foucault, Bourdieu, Birgit Sauer, Brigitte Aulenbacher, feminist scholars, Klaus Dörre, and we use mainly Polanyi as an economic historian. But at the end I also will get to some concepts we are discussing here at this conference. So our opening problem is an interesting contradiction. There is since 2008-2009 the Copenhagen Conference on Climate Change might be a watershed for also the G7 protests in 2007 in Heiligendamm. There is a repoliticization of the ecological crisis or even the multiple crisis. Cornelia Klinger used this concept as well. But despite many activities, there is, despite many talks, the Paris Agreement, a year ago we would have still discussed what happened in December 15 in Paris at this climate change conference. Despite research programs on transformation towards sustainability, despite the report of the German Council on Global Environmental Change, we discussed it in the morning, there is still the real world is going towards a very, very different direction, which is a still very deepening of the ecological crisis, of climate change, of resource use. There's still an overproportionate excess of the global resources, mainly by the global norms. This is the first contradiction. And the second is that the globalization process as such is also can also be read by a generalization, which does not mean verallgemeinerung, which does not mean everything is similar, but the generalization of the imperial mode of living, the Western way of life, if you like, and among the middle classes of the global south in China. Four of our articles now were translated on the imperial mode of living into Mandarin, because obviously it helps critical scholars there to understand what's happening in China. And I said this already yesterday in the discussion, we should also look at the world from a perspective, from an angle that the struggles over the externalization of the preconditions of our mode of living, which always means also the mode of production, yeah? It's not the lifestyle. The mode of living means also production. And that there are maybe increasingly struggles over the externalization not only of the negative costs, but also of the preconditions of the imperial mode of living. So this is a bit problematic. We want to do that. The core ideas of the imperial mode of living to understand the inadequate societal response to the multiple crises. Ecological crisis is our empirical field, if you like, to the multiple crises. And to link for this purpose the everyday life, the everyday reproduction, which is not only our everyday when we go to the supermarket or when we eat, but also the everyday in the work world, yeah, or in political institutions, to link this everyday functionings with destruction. I quote from an article from 2012 with Marcus, the improved mode of living is principally based on an unlimited appropriation of resources and labor power, and on a disproportionate claim to global sins. Sins comes out of the climate change debate, the ability to capture emissions, CO2 emissions through oceans and mainly through forests, and when they are destroyed the forest, then there's also problems global sins. And in the constellation of the multiple crises, it contributes to safeguarding social stability in the global north and provides a hegemonic orientation in many societies of the global south. This is what we said 5 years ago, and we would even sharpen the argument to say that the strategies and the processes of externalization do function less and less. And these causes conflicts over land, over resources, over the very possibility to externalize. So we have, I want to introduce some facets, and this is now the point where I'm really nervous, because we added in the bookmaking and in the discussions some dimensions compared to our formula. We still try to look at the imperial mode of living from a strategic perspective. Of course, there are private companies, there are state politics, there is neocolonialism, there is knowledge production, science, research and development that assures the security of the imperial mode of living. There are discursive aspects, dispositives, if you like, of progress, of a good living, which is not the Andreas Novi good living for all. I was on this line, but the good living to have cars, to meet, to fly cheaply, and so on. There are patriarchal dimensions, instrumental rationality, which also add to this discursive dimension. And there is, this is our point with Bourdieu, with the Athletic and Michael Jonas from Vienna, there is this everyday practices, which has to do with practices, habitus, yeah, with the incorporated, and Cornelia Klinger mentioned the bodies, which is very often forgotten in critical thinking, and I agree with this, the status, consumption, the looking for the own status, and for the own success. And then in the last year we discussed that beside these, let's say, dimensions to understand the complexity of the imperial mode of living and of its reproduction, we thought about four, let's say, driving forces, or when you argue from a critical realist perspective, kind of causal mechanisms. The first is quite obvious here in this group, it's the capitalist valorization, commodification of land, of labor, of nature, the accumulation and reproduction dynamics, the land taking, as Klaus Dörbel and Gutzel. The second aspect, which is sometimes forgotten in these, let's say, capitalist thinking, is what we call hegemony from a Gramscian perspective, and which is present, of course, and subjectivation. Yeah, we refer to Harald Welzer's work, a social psychologist who argues with the concept of the mental infrastructures. Yes, that the desire to grow, to have more, has also to do with the subjectivation and the habitualization of bodies on earth. The third aspect is that the imperial mode of living is based on inequalities, and it reproduces inequalities. We call it hierarchization. The imperial mode of living is not only, I come back to this, the north-south hierarchization, but also within our societies. Yeah? The status consumption, this Babylon, if you like, is it's a constant reproduction of these imperial mode of living, or the class hierarchization, I come back to this as well. And the fourth aspect, and this is then, let's say, this is our contribution, if you like, to look more precisely on these many-fold processes of externalization. We call it, in German, Andernorts, and we leave it like this elsewhere. Andernorts. The Andernorts is not present in the everyday. What does Carajás mean, the production of aluminium in the north of Brazil? What happened in November 2015 in the south of Brazil, when a dam was broken, all these waste of metal and aluminium production destroyed the river and went to the Atlantic Ocean? What happens when the electronic waste goes to African countries? But even what is happening in China, where China is producing for our everyday life. Here comes a bit the regulationist perspective we have, and this is our background, that the imperial mode of living is based on and secures a certain functionality of societal reproduction. Of course, of the capitalist reproduction, if department one, department two, and the norms of consumption don't interfere well, we have a crisis. At a recent seminar, and with Sonja Buchel, John Kanangulam, Jens Wissel, some of you might know them, we thought about department zero. Department one is production of the means of production, department two is production of the means of consumption, and then consumption, the department zero might be the material, the input of resources into these production and accumulation processes. So the functionality basis on the ignorance of ignoring the productivity of nature, it is exactly the externalization of the negative consequences, as I said, and it's also a part of the expansive capitalist mode of production. And a point which makes sense, in terms of Urban is here, and we discussed this also with trade unionists in Austria and Germany, which makes it so uneasy to think to go beyond the imperial mode of living towards a solidarity mode of living, is that also the reproduction of the workforce is easier in certain places like Germany or Austria, or in some even better than elsewhere, when the imperial mode of living is reproduced successfully. What we now experience in the crisis, yeah, where the crisis takes place, how is it externalized, and how the everyday here is stabilized through the imperial mode of living. I leave this to the carbon democracy audience. How much time do I have? Then we were at the beginning of our, when we introduced the concept, we were sometimes criticized, Stefan Schneitz from Vienna and others. So this is, it's you don't have a class perspective. We would say, yes, we have a class perspective because we have this, we consider this hierarchization. We have also, I would say, it's also articulated with the gender perspective or with the perspective on racialized social relations. And I want to emphasize two aspects. One is that the size of the so-called ecological footprint, we have many, many studies on this, strongly correlates with income. Not necessarily. We know that now from the capitalist centers that the meat consumption is not depending on income. But in general, we can state this causality. And that the practically lived modes of living are also milieu-specific. Yeah? We have this famous milieus from Zenos. And it's also a question of distinction, which reproduces this hierarchization for middle and upper classes. However, and this brings me back to this uneasiness to introduce the concept and to think emancipation, that it's also the imperial mode of living in certain places is a form of reproducing the workforce and to lower the cost of reproduction. Yeah, when certain commodities are every day, every year cheaper, or at least they don't become more expensive, then it has to do with the cost of production. It enhances, this is a bit the carbon democracy concept by Timothy Mitchell, we can come back to this in the discussion. Carbon democracy means that the imperial mode of living enhances social integration and material participation. Like the democratic capitalism, the Fordist mode of production was heavily a carbon democratic one. We also should look more carefully on this on compensatory consumption in an alienated world. Geizesgeil, greed is cool, or and such things. Yeah. And maybe also the Saturday activities in the supermarket, which is a real suggestion, or suggestion of possibilities to choose between. Very quickly, because we have this present here with many state theories, we refer also to the imperial mode of living state and policies. We see the strategic dimension I mentioned at the beginning, and we understand with Bob Jessop, Nikos Polanzas, and many others, the state as a social relation and the condensation of societal power relations, which helps us to understand that it's the strength of the existing imperial mode of living, and that the state largely assures the functionality, the related interest of the imperial mode of living, and this makes alternative politics and policies so difficult. Yeah, and the minimum is now, I'm a pessimist by the intellect, but the most what can be expected now is a kind of ecological modernization, the energy transition in Germany, if you like, but it's very, very difficult to go beyond. And then we have a global dimension, which is, as I said at the beginning, the deepening of the imperial mode of living, not only in the global north. We can see this in many, many figures since neoliberalism, neoliberal globalization, but also among the middle classes of the global south. And this does not mean that everybody lives equally, but that it's obviously very, very attractive in the global south, and that it's a motor, it's an engine behind this globalization process to live like in the west. As Wolfgang Sachs said once in the 90s, die im Westen so auf Erden, like in the west, so worldwide or on earth. So I leave it here. I think the thought is clear that it's the imperial of living is a logic of development. Yeah? It becomes hegemonic in the sense that it's not a question. Yeah? If you go to Latin America, I'm more familiar with than with other continents, the enormous growth since 2003, 2004, due to the high commodity price and high demand, was deepening the imperial of living. Yes, I'm done. I come now to the deals with Polanyi. As I said at the beginning, we refer to him mainly as an economic historian with very, of course, important quotes and thoughts. And this is, we interchange, if you like, many parts of the book, Marx and Polanyi, because they say, Marx we use also more analytically, but those tell us a lot about the highly conflictive character of the introduction of industrial capitalism, about commodification, about the role of the state in the imposition of industrial, and we always call it, of course, industrial fossilist capitalism, because it went hand in hand, industrialization and fossilism, which is then, let's say, within our debate, mainly often forgotten. And also, we take this Polanyi's thought that the nation state, to him, he observed, was the most appropriate or a more appropriate form to organize the market economy or capitalism. Yeah, not so much the empires, but we can also question this historically, but we would argue that there was a tendency that the nation state was more embodied. Then we diverge a bit from Polanyi when we refer to this debate on the Great Transformation. There was the Great Transformation towards capitalism and then towards this re-embedding, but as Christoph said already, Christoph Berg in the morning, we refer also to what Will Steffen called the Great Acceleration, that Fordism is, from a social-ecological perspective, is Fordism, the post-war period, another great transformation. Yeah, the introduction of oil. Yeah, it's not oil only for engines, for energy, but oil within the products. Yeah. We cannot imagine our everyday life without oil. This is the second acceleration, transformation. And the second, we argue, is the neoliberal globalization in the sense that it's an intensification in the global north and a generalization among the middle classes in the global south. And today, against these very normative or political and strategic discussion on sustainability transformations, we argue it's a bit naive because they want a lot politically, but they underestimate analysis. And we argue, and I just attach it because we had this this morning, beside the business as usual, the brown fossilist and authoritarian forms of capitalism, there might be a great transformation towards a green economy. This is hoped by many, let's say, left liberals in Austria, Germany, where the bioeconomy debate, and then the question is, and what is the solidarity mode of living, green socialism? And I end with a thought by Michael Brie. We also refer, of course, to his work in our book, that he, with others, but for the German debate, I think he made this point in his book, that Polanyi is not the theorist only of the Sabbat movement, but he argued mainly that the crisis of liberalism means that the solution of the crisis might not be within or under the capitalist framework. He was wrong historically, as we know, with Fordism, but maybe this is an important thought today. So, to finish, we argue that the imperial mode of living helps us to understand that all the attempts to stabilize the capitalist mode of production and to intensify the capitalist mode of production undermines societal and natural relations and might to lead to, or is already leading to a civilizational crisis. And this is, and we had these debates already at this conference, we'll continue to have it, to think and to look in detail where are the experiences towards the solidarity mode of living beyond capitalism. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much to all speakers to speak very closely to the time frame. We have some 20-25 minutes for discussion now, and I open the floor to you, to the wider audience. Do you have questions? Start with you, and you can think. take questions and then we're going to have a round of
discussion that we have here, and I think I have to start with my reading plan. It actually gives me an understanding of patterns and regularities and say that capitalism or the market is driving us into dispossession, that human society is being dispossessed as a result of commodification of fictitious commodities. And he was directly saying that he does not have to discuss about how human labor is reproduced, because the critique, fictitious labor is fictitious commodity, directly tells us that we cannot reproduce it as human persons. And so we do not have the right to marketize labor. But on the process, if we speak of caregiving, what we have in our country is also the experience of the phenomena we call the Filipino diaspora. Our OFWs, overseas Filipino workers, go abroad, take care of the families of foreigners or the senior citizens of foreign states, and they leave their families behind, careless. Okay? But they have to go out and earn. So they are dispossessed of families. Families are dispossessed of care on the process of proletarianization of circulators. And again, we speak of imperial modes of living. We're talking about livable cities, livable nation states, and livable world. How possible is that? How can conferences of academics like us really speak of genuine assets reforms and genuine assets redistribution and intervene into society and make changes? That's the decisive question I would like to ask.
Thank you. Over there. Sure.
Excuse me, I'm Gareth from London. My question is for Uli. I'll stand so I can see you because I can't hear. Our sightline is blocked there. I was struck by some of the parallels with the work of what's his name, Klaus Lessenich, I think, sociologist.
Stefan Lessenich.
Yes. Thank you. In his book, The Externalisierungsgesellschaft, which I think came out this year. I mean, the focus on the word externalisierung in both of your works were similar, and even some of the examples that you were using, for instance, the dam in Brazil that burst and the dumping of electronics waste in Africa were similar. And so I was wondering if you could say a little more on, or say something about whether his project is part of a kind of unified collaborative project with yours, or I can also see some differences between his analysis and your analysis. I was wondering if you could say something on that. And also, the question of living standards, I wonder how you tackle this delicate issue of living standards strategically. The attempt is to build movements, to build a strong eco-socialist movement, and yet your analysis, of course, is suggesting that some of the core aspects of people's lives, driving freely with cars, eating steaks, flying six times a year to academic conferences, and so on, are a serious problem. How do you address this issue? I know it's a big question, but I wonder if you could say a few words on that.
Okay, I take a third one and then we make a round of them. So you, in the fourth one?
Giesecke from Linz Capital University. I have just two brief questions, one for Brigitte, one for Uli. Brigitte, I'm wondering why you would consider care as a separate commodity from labor. That was an issue I think Michael also raised yesterday. Could you expand on that, please? And Uli, I'm wondering how far back in history you go with your analysis. I don't know if you know the book that recently came out by Sven Beckert on the history of capitalism, based on the case of cotton, where he basically really nicely shows how the history of capitalism has always been violent and extremely imperial. I mean, he shows the origins of that. So this is just maybe a way of even going back further and strengthening your argument.
Okay. Okay, we can go for the first round and then podium now. Who wants to begin?
This question of Filipino diaspora will answer. Brigitte, I learned a lot from Robin Rodriguez's work and also Birgit Sauer's that we should also look at this contradictory characters. It's dispossession, but also maybe some aspects of emancipation, but you are much more familiar with this work. Yes, Stefan Lessenich, we are in touch. I'm a fellow of the Post-Growth Societies Research Group in Vienna. I was there. And analytically, I would argue that Stefan describes with a strong hypothesis quite well what's happening in a very similar way. But he says at the introduction throughout this book, of course we have class societies, but to him it's if the North have more, the South has less. And he doesn't think our strong aspect is the generalization through the global middle classes in the global South. This is not his issue. He comes from a, let's say, very orthodox, it's not fair. We know each other, and we will have in 2 weeks and a workshop together and so on, so I can say this publicly. I would say it's an orthodox dependency theory. And we try to understand these everyday aspects, the subject relation, let's say the mechanisms of externalization society or the imperial mode of living. I would say this is a very important difference, but maybe also Klaus, who is much more in the debate, can say something. The question of living standards, and coming back to your point, what are we doing here, sitting around and having nice talks? I would consider myself as member or part of this ultra-globalization movement, and my question is just how to intervene. And I think, and we will have afterwards a workshop on this, the degrowth movement makes an important point for the global norms, and I work on Latin America, the post-extractivist perspective. How can we have, and this was also Polanyi thought, and Michael points to this in his book as well, how can we have a prosperous, a fair, a livable standard of living without going into the trap, Nikopech, some of you might know in Germany and others, the Verzicht, that we have too much and that we have, it's a very Protestant ethic, yeah, that we, due to the enormous amount of problems, we have to reduce our lives and Befreiung vom Überfluss means if we have less, we feel better and so on. Yeah? And this is something for the Kirchentag, very productive, I was with him on many podiums, but it's not an emancipatory perspective, because emancipation starts with those who have less space to act. And these are the subaltern. And so I would say the degrowth is not a nice word to have less, but it's a perspective to question and in perspective to get out of the capitalist growth imperative, which is not degrowth to have less, but of a societal constellation. Degrowth means a societal constellation where we are constantly confronted with the capitalist growth imperative. And this, I would say, is the difference. And then I would say, I want to contribute as a scholar, but also as an activist, to these debates, and also maybe in our, or hopefully in our academic practice. And to Elke's point, yes, I know Sven personally also, but also the book, we start with colonialism. Since our point is Latin America, Eduardo Galeano, and all these Buddhism, we are hobby historians, and let's say firearmed, yes, spare time historians, and we tried our best, yeah, to condense on 60 pages of the book the history of the imperial mode of living, but we don't, our point is not to write a history of the imperial mode of living, but to show with some specific examples how the imperial mode of living, even in the 19th century, was contested. And we argue for the 1970s, and the 1970s, that was an open window due to the ecological movement, the radical workers' movement, to really enter or to politicize the imperial mode of living. It's much more, it's not a history, if you like, it's a historical take to show the plausibility of our argument, yeah, which is the question of contestation, the question of externalization, the question of hierarchization. We write about the Zapatistas in Chiapas, in what sense they tried to politicize the imperial mode of living in the 90s, and so on.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much for these questions. First to the field plan case, I didn't take this case because I wanted to take the case in Austria in this case. I will talk about a difference. If you do research on the advertisement of the religion case, that's really interesting. I present what in Vienna is advertised in the care agencies, professionality, legal arrangements, emotions, and. If you are looking on the care agencies, we had such an example in Singapore, who are recruiting Philippines. They advertise no fees, low pay, no day off. The new mates, happy mates, happy homes. And the working conditions are legalized, as in Austria. There is a violent organization of care work inside the household, and you cannot compare that. And that's the point I wanted to make. There is an arrangement, a care arrangement, which take care as a business case. Care agencies all around the world are recruiting migrant female care workers to the different conditions of the countries. In Austria, they are very different from Singapore and Philippines, and you have different forms of, I call it modern slavery, which is discussed, worldwide discussed. We have a lot of protest of domestic workers, and which worldwide is discussed and in a special condition accepted. We have done interviews in Austria and Vienna, and Aulenbacher had done one part of these interviews. In this part you find the employer's statements. That is a kind of slavery. No Austrian woman would do that. But I have nobody for my mother. I cannot be there 24 hours. I know that. I would pay more, but if I pay more, I cannot get anything else than this. So, and the interesting point is, a lot of questions are arising. Justice, solidarity, a deep going criticism of capitalism, of exploitation. They speak in these interviews of exploitation. They do this exploitation as employers. But it's a difficult, therefore I talk about pitting of precarities. It's a global pitting of precarities. In one country they are looking for support, for caring, and they accept this form of expropriation to serve the imperial mode of living. It's an imperial mode of living that is accepted and criticized, both. Accepted, legitimated, criticized, and so on. That's one point I want to make. And the other point is, you are right, we have to interfere. There are a lot of protest movements joined by sociologists. I'm from sociology, I only can speak for sociology, including our public sociology. And one of our collaboration is in, one of our collaboration partner, by example, is in the domestic care network Respect, Respect in Switzerland, and they have a large protest movement, and they could realize a new legal statement status that this availability that you have to be 24 hours in this household is now a pet time. That makes the difference between the world. Because if you are living unpaid there, or if that's a pet time and you have a new situation to negotiate about such conditions. But that's only one example. Yes, you are right, we have to interfere in such situations. The next question has been from Elke. That's the more difficult one, because I'm not sure why we make this distinction. So care is not labor, and care work is not care.
And indeed, I'm asking, I'm not sure, whether we have to consider care as a fictitious commodity similar to labor, or in which connection, in which relation to labor. I have no answer. I tried it, and I tried it because a commodification of care is not an extended commodification of labor. It's another part of commodification of social reproduction. If you take the example of surrogacy, you have a commodification of the body, a commodification of care, and a commodification of labor. And I'm asking. I have not the answer.
One of the questions, one of the questions directly, and but I would like to take up Brigitte's point about the question in care is a fictitious commodity or not. I think care is one example that we are getting closer to the production and to the commodification of science and bodies, and this means life. And this is what is so pressing about this problem, because I think our hunch is, all of us would agree on that, that you can buy and sell goods, but you cannot buy and sell a good life. And of course you do, but then you're producing inequalities among classes, genders, and also on the global scale, within regions or between regions of the world. And so the predicament I feel very strongly is that we have nobody to turn to. Actually, I'm less sanguine and optimistic about social movements. We have had social movements to accompany the development of state, nation-state, and capitalism all over since Polanyi's beloved Polanyi's and Robert Owen. We had social movements, and in a sense, they were useful and they were important, and they improved the world we are living in. But so far, I do not see that they go beyond. But with the pressing problem of life, and not only what we have, but what we are, is commodified. And this will continue in a more dramatic way in the reproductive technologies, and also, and we have it already in the ICT. In the information and communication industries. This is unstoppable. I do not see any way out. And with social movements, I repeat myself, they improve something. They kind of mitigate something. They make things milder. But so far, I do not see any step beyond. We have been, our generation has been believing in social movements since the very start. And what we see is the continuation of the division of the world in imperialist lifestyles and the servants, and the servants, and servitude. And on the other hand, we are at a loss with the nation state. I didn't elaborate that very much, but the nation state is the only stable institution of protection, while social movements kind of move about and move around and do this and that and do. And I do not want to denigrate it, but it does not change the system. And on the other hand, the nation state as a protector is at the same time a form of domination. And it is another causation of inequalities of all kinds. And
yes, there is a tendency over the last months or years to go back to the protectionism of the nation state. It will not work out. It will not work out because we have this massive industrial revolution of the production of our being, and not only of the goods we consume, but we are consumed. This, by the way, this is not no news. This is since capitalism came into being.
Okay, thank you. We have time for a quick last round and an immediate answer, but do you want to answer immediately? No? Yeah. Okay. We have two additional remarks from the audience. You and you. Birgit? Yes, sir. Professor, okay, then you have three.
I just don't without the mic and I hope you could hear me. I would like to ask the same question. I cried already. Shout out my face.
Thank you. I would have had the same question if they had about care and about just a commodity and I'd like Cornelia and Brigitte to talk to each other what already happened. But still I'd like to add, because it's really a search for an answer, as you said, and we do not have an answer. But me, as I did work on emotions and effects and the body, I think it's an interesting way you're going to, because also emotions and effects are commodified. They are not labeled, but of course there is affective labor, there is emotional labor. But this is something different, and I think it's worth going on to into this direction, asking, what is the body, how can we grasp the body as a commodity, so it's, but how can we also grasp interactions of bodies, and this is the notion of effects, and maybe this helps in going more into detail, what is the commodity that is, or what is the fictitious commodity of care, and I try to work with effects as fictitious commodities. And the second remark is more to Cornelia about her pessimism. So maybe if we could say, if we have a little bit different notion of the state, we could say, well, the state, the capitalist, the bourgeois patriarchal state, is the institutionalization of social movements, of the bourgeois movement, of socialist movement, and so on. So maybe we could also say, of course, it's not the liberal capitalist state which is protected today. But anyway, starting from this different notion of state, we might get a more optimistic version and say, well, it, of course, it's a struggle if and how movements are able to institutionalize different forms of protection. And I have to stop. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you, Megan. Next speaker, over there, and then Bob. Ah, there's another one there.
Yeah, I thought, hello. You. Hello, I'm Tom Sauer, an economist from Vienna and Berlin. And I actually want to pick up the question raised by Cornelia. What could be an entirely different purpose? I think this is a central question. It's actually also referring to Klaus Dohler's question this morning, what are the concepts the left has to offer in the current debate? This is actually the question that's around. And I think this question I would apply to the last slide of Uli's presentation, was the generalization, globalization of the imperial mode of living is undermining the social tone, natural relations, as far as I remember. So, but what does it mean, undermining social natural relation? What kind of social natural relation do I have in mind when you are writing this and saying this? This is actually the idea that there is a general optimal state of these relations. This is a state. I guess it's perhaps a kind of idealization of this relations between man and nature, humans and nature. And I think if we want to develop a new concept, we should think about this, what we actually mean. And so I understand your question. What is actually the entirely different purpose? What could it be? And I think this should be the general question about our debates when we're discussing about the future. And if you got one question, if you briefly mentioned China, but when you say, okay, in China now there is also an imperial mode of living, which means they are simply richer than 10 or 20 years ago, they have higher purchasing power, and this consumerism stops or mitigates actually a political movement in China. So consumerism is actually the mode of the political power to keep the people quiet in China. And what does it mean actually for the alternative?
Okay, thank you. The next one from Jessup. Then we will just do it here. Can you give me the microphone?
There's a couple of very quick comments for Brigitte. It's whether or not one could draw more parallels between a Marxist analysis of labour power in the factory and labour power here. If you think labour power before it's a commodity is simply the capacity to perform labour, then clearly care work is effective labour. I think the reason why perhaps you're reluctant just to consider it, considered primarily as concrete labour rather than abstract labour, because everything has to be customised to a particular family, a particular care situation, and so forth. And the analogy would be the cooking art system, or the formal subsumption of labour under here some sort of familial control. But then what we can see, and I think your case studies show this very interestingly, there are a whole series of ways where you're trying to standardize concrete labor so it becomes assimilable to abstract labor. So one can think firstly of the economies of scale that come from firms that provide a very large number of care workers. One can then think of all the standardized training that goes into that, including the docile but caring bodies that need autonomy, but only within certain limits, and so forth. And I think if one started to think that this is not already abstract labour, but the trend within care work is to try to turn it as far as possible into abstract labour, but there are a whole series then of very practical, emotional obstacles to integrating care work directly in the form of abstract labour. And there the distinction, putting out formal subsumption as opposed to real subsumption on the supply chain in terms of the work delivered, but on the other side, how you organise it can be seen increasingly as subject to forms of commodification and so forth. So it's a supplement to what you're saying, which might address some of the issues where there could be some similarities.
Good, thank you. I will cut off the debate here. I'm sorry to everyone else who wanted to say something and hand over to the audience, as we're already running late a bit. And I ask for some quick and final answers to the question. Let's start with Birgitte now.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Bob. You are right. Care is becoming more and more labor as usual. And nevertheless, there's one point to Birgit too. I have in my mind the triangle between labor, care, and nature. And I think that's the problem, to get this triangle, because care is not a synonym for labor, and it's not becoming labor. It's becoming more and more similar. But you cannot reduce care on labor, and therefore, for me, it's the question at the moment. But thank you very much for all these exciting ideas.
Cornelia?
Yeah,
it helps somewhat to think about labor as to make my thoughts a bit clearer. I think we have the question of purpose. We have to reconsider this question of purpose. And if I may put it very bluntly, because we have no time, the purpose of all our endeavors, and not only in the imperial mode of life, but also in the emanations of this imperial mode of life, is the purpose the last purpose has become having instead of being. And if we want to turn things around, and I think we have to turn things around, we have not to ask how far can care become abstract work, but we have to ask how much can abstract work become closer to care. And if I may utter something like utopian vision, it is a solidarity in society which makes us mutually care for each other. There's nobody else and no power in the world to protect us from anything, but we have to protect each other. And it is not how far can care work be assimilated to the production of goods, but how far can the production of goods be again assimilated, and also I try to say this to be under the production of life. And I know that this sounds very fundamental, but I do not want to understand it as fundamental as I pronounce it, because we have no ontology behind it. We do not know the purposes of life. We have to define them, but we have to be aware that nobody else defines it for us, and we have to do it in solidarity. And I think that at the basis of solidarity is the reciprocity of care. And this is, by the way, a mode of life between non-equals. We are not equal. And we have to consider that we are not equal, and we have to care for each other on this life cycle in which we are not equal.
Thank you. Ulrich, for the final.
Yes, short remarks. I just want to say to Cornelia Klinger, I very much disagree, not with your pessimism, but with your focus on social movements, a bit like Birgit. We call our part of our final chapter the often unspectacular emergence of solidarity modes of living. So what in your take of the nation state and the social movements are obviously explicit actors, and we should look also, not exclusive, but also on the alternative practices. So if young people stop eating meat, this has quite a lot of effects of a machinery of agricultural production in Austria. So I would propose to broaden a bit our perspective. Where are these different forms of practices also emerging? Put it like this, and afterwards we can discuss it further. To Tom's point, I found it a very important thought. If I say the undermining of society and natural relations, I mean the danger of the very reproducibility, the reproduzierbarkeit, the form to reproduce life. This is not only nature out there, resources, but the forms how society reproduces itself, and it's biophysical, but also in other aspects. And I would say this is not a planetary boundary argument, but it's a very important argument to look at these undermining and how life reproduces. And the last remark, it's coming back to this question, what is critical social science? Garris and you said it. And just a quick promotion. We produced a book last November for Christoph Scherer, a scholar and a professor at Kassel University, to analyze, criticize, and shape globalization. You have it upstairs on the bookshelf. And it's not only very nice articles from Christa Wischler on care, but it's also some very, very interesting articles on what is critical social sciences and critical political sciences at an institutional level and also at a level of content about. So those who read German, unfortunately only in German, have a look on the book.
Okay, thank you very much to the audience. Thank you very much to the podium for this lively and interesting discussion. You can see on the time that it was very interesting that we overdrew, and we continue in about 20 minutes.